been exaggerating because I wanted to make a point. Science is not useless. The research is not useless. It is the perspective, it is the way we put to use that has been wrong. If you find using it in the right way, in the right perspective, all of that, we found that it took me 20 years to find out what is the correct way, what is the right way to make use of research and science. And then we were able to put it to use and make huge amount of money. See, if you are able to use it in the correct way, and that is what I'm going to show you, you are able to make huge amounts of profit. Now, we will see this, but let me give you a measure of this. Let me give an indicator of this. Now, let us accept me for a moment that I found a magic formula to make money in farming after having failed for about 20 years. I have found a way of doing it. Now, what is that way? I have done it here. You can see that. You can see that. And I will also talk about it. So I have done that. Now, how good is this new way of doing things, making money in farming under rainfall situations? How good is this? Let me give you an example. This company, I started in this company as a consultant. Okay, somebody. So why did they call me? This 86 acres of land was rainfall land. They tried to put bore wells. You know, you understand bore wells? You dig a hole in the well to take out water and use it for irrigation. They sank about 40 bore wells, they could not get water. So they didn't know what to do with this land. They knew that I am a bit crazy researcher. So they came to me, the company approached me and said, here is 86 acres of land, can you make some money out of it? So by then, I had done a few things. I made a presentation to the board of the company, board of directors. Told them, X is the investment. And I can deliver you 2X returns. ROIs, you know, return on investment, standard. ROIs, 3 years. I can deliver that to you. Now, this company does not understand farming, right? They are a company which does pharmaceuticals, herbal pharmaceuticals. So they have no background in pharmaceuticals. But they understand money, right? They understand profits. They said, if X is the investment and if you can deliver 2X in 3 years, then I said 5X in 5 years, all that, I'll commit. So they simply looked at the business case and said, yes, if you are able to honor your word, if you can keep up your word, go ahead, we will give you the investment. So I took that investment in 2009, okay, and I started. This has worked well. How do I say it has worked well? 2011, from the consultant, I became the vice president of this company. Now, I am the vice president of this company. For some time, it was mostly for decorative. They were kind of calling me vice president. Now, they have really made me vice president, where I get lots of work. That is the bad part. So, I am the vice president. And then, see, companies don't make somebody from a consultant to a vice president unless it is profitable to them. So this is one clear proof that whatever we have done has brought enough money to the company. Company sees the potential. That's one part. The second part, like any good company, they said, you have done it in 100 acres. Will you do it in 500? Will you do it in 1,000? We'll pay you. Do it in 500. Replicate it. Upscale it. Make more money. Make more profits. By then, I had become a little smart. I said, no, thank you very much. If you want me to do it, why do I do it for you? You will only give me a small percentage of the profit I generate, right? I do it for myself. Isn't it? I took this idea, presented it to investors, international investors. Said, this is a business case I have. Now, can you fund me? Yes. I got enough investment. Okay. Using this idea, I got enough investment from international sources. Venture capitalists, we got enough money, and then, I mean, I cannot manage this, whom do I find? Then I talked to my friends in software. I mean, there were people who were in Microsoft, Wipro, they left their jobs. These are senior managers. They left their jobs, and now they are partnering with me to do the, to implement this model. Now, these people are hard-headed business people. They did not resign from their job for any ideological reasons. They resigned it for profit. Okay? They saw enough profits in this. Now I have partners with me about 10 kilometers from this place, where we have our own plot, which is very different from this plot, in which ex-Microsoft, ex-Wipro, they are working as managers and they are implementing the same model there. So these are just examples to show that whatever we have done here can generate enough profits. So that is the story. I will come to the upscaling part a little later, but this is the story that has happened. So from a situation where I was struggling to make profits, now I have arrived at a situation where I am very comfortable with profits. Okay? Not only me, there are others who see that there are enough profits. Okay.
So what happened to that X factory? X
and then what happened? Okay. See, now we have already given them 2X. Now we are looking at, I believe we should have done 5X. Okay. We should have done 5X last year, but we have not. For some reason, I have got this analysis. Our average rainfall of this place, I am talking of 100 year average, 1901 onwards till now, is about 66 centimeters. 66 centimeters is a 100 year average, annual average rainfall. From 2010 onwards, we have never crossed 40. So there is a minus one standard deviation. So there is a deficit. For four consecutive years, okay, and this Professor J. Srinivasan of IISc checked this out because they were interesting. And this is an event which has not happened in 100 years. Minus one standard deviation from the average has never happened in the past 100 years. So this is a rare event and we were hit by that. In spite of that, we have done well. I believe right now we are at 4x, we are not at 5x. But even that by conventional standards is quite good. So they didn't kick me out. Still retained me.
What is this?
Then again, there is one more, Dr. Ruth is also there. She is in adaptation group. So with them. So then there are also lots of. So this is reality. So I work with one of them. Okay. So this is something which I have already told you the story. Okay. This is the story. First, there are many ways to look at our work. So I thought I will retain climate as the focus. I said, is there a demand for climate information? Okay. Then we talk of our work, that whatever I did, all this user-driven research, you know, appropriate technology research, we try to do this adaptation, that I'll talk to you. Then what is our recent success, how we have done? Then why did we succeed? We will try to show you the design principles. Then what is interest is, how do we plan to upscale it? This is not just a one-off exercise where I have made money from my... The system is so complex. Many of you must have heard of complex system. In a complex system, there is a very different approach that you need to take, and our approach was wrong. So even though we did quite well, we got publications, it was useless on ground. So this is something which I want to stress. The academic research which can become excellent papers often will not translate to anything meaningful, anything practical on ground. And this has been our experience. Okay. So this has been our experience. Sorry, I'll just switch. Okay. We will skip all this. Then I thought maybe I was a little stupid. You know, we tried to follow the same methodology with agricultural universities, 10 agricultural universities in India. See, these are the agricultural universities in India. This was the project I did with Columbia University. So I was leading the team of, we tried to do a similar methodology of user-driven research on cropping patterns with 10 agricultural universities in India. Again, 5 meters. The soil is that. So from 1 meter, usually in our mind when we think of crop, you look at 1 meter of soil, but you can utilize up to 5 meters. Now we are looking at 5 meters. So that 5 meters of soil, you would completely charge it with the moisture. How we do it, we will talk about it there. So charge it with the moisture. So you immediately increase your water availability by 5 times. Right? because you are charging more. So this is the savings bank that I was talking about. This soil moisture bank, which is stored up to 5 meters, is your asset. Now, we use that asset to grow trees because crops cannot drain soil moisture more than 1 meter. The roots are not deep enough. So the only roots that are deep enough are trees. So we use the trees of the roots of the trees to pick up the moisture from 5 meters. So we use that. And now most of the soils are poor. So in trees, how do you get nutrients? You see, the soils are very poor, so they don't grow. We use 75% of the trees to provide nutrients for the 25%. You want the 25% to grow fast, so 75% of the trees are used to provide nutrients for the 25%. Again, you will see this. Okay, this is an important principle. Otherwise, how do you bring nutrients? You can't bring nitrogen, phosphorus, potash, you know, which is all petrochemicals which are costly. You can't bring it. So you can generate nutrients right there. So this is the nutrient supply which comes from trees. Third, once you provide water, once you provide organic matter, what happens in nature? I don't know how many of you come from biology, but this is basic biology. Once you give food and once you give water, in tropics, what happens? Microbes. Microbes come in a huge way. We have got measurements to tell you how much microbes we come, and very high root activity, very high microbes come, and based on this, you create a very high growth. So what happens is, rainwater, then lots of tree roots, and then water and tree roots generate microbes. Once microbes come, root activity comes, you enter into something called as a virtuous cycle. So in tropics, I know less about temperate countries, but in tropics, nature is extremely powerful. Okay? You are aware of a rule that for every 10 degree rise in temperature, the microbial activity doubles. Okay? So tropics, very high activity of microbes. Very, very powerful natural cycles take place. So it generates a virtuous cycle. And this virtuous cycle actually propels our whole growth forward. So we make use of natural, virtuous, ecological cycles to increase our growth. People coming from temperate countries don't realize that in temperate countries, sunlight is a constraint for growth. Here, you have so much sunlight. I think it is 28 megajoules per meter square. Now that's what JS tells me. So here, the sunlight is in so much abundance that in 50% shade, you will have full growth. 50% shade, you will have full growth. Because the sunlight is so much that the plants switch off their photosynthesis, called photosaturation. They switch off because the engine is getting heated up. The radiation is so much that to avoid overheating, the plants switch off during many times of the day. So at 50% shade, we will have full photosynthesis. So this is the power of tropics. So we use that to generate very high growth, even in shade. Okay, now, as I said, by training I am a researcher. We have collected a lot of data. We can discuss it a little later. So I have done a nutrient budgeting. In this system, 2002, we looked at nutrient measurement. One time, we put biomass as a nutrient input. You will see all this in the field. Just keep this data in the background, then you end up with a positive balance 4 years later. So you have abundance of nutrients. So this is all properly done, under experimental design. Keep this in mind that you have a positive nutrient balance. Similarly, we have done water balance. We have done microbial studies. I will not go into all this. We have plenty of data to show you, but we will not done. So will you take my word that we have done all the studies, we have done all the data, all of them support that we have a balance. While we did this system, now I want to wrap this up, there were a few larger scale benefits. Why did I start this? I started this system to make more profits, right? It was not my intention to do anything else. So we arrived at this particular design. You will see the design, but this design has certain benefits which I did not think of. You know, I did not intend for those benefits. I did not plan for them. One is, this is completely organic. Our source of nutrients is completely biomass. There is no need for pesticides because the species diversity is so high that you don't get any pests and diseases. Right? When you have very high species diversity, your chance of getting diseases and pests are quite less. So you don't need chemicals either for nutrients or for plant protection, so it becomes completely organic. This is very high in biodiversity because you remember the landscape which was mostly barren, there was nothing. You suddenly have a cluster of trees. All the birds, all the insects, all the frogs, everything tries to come and stay in that little island where there is some greenery, right? So there is a concept called refugia. This is the only place where they find. So everything comes together and has. So you will have very high levels of biodiversity. Mostly because these act as refugia. So biodiversity huge increases, and we have measured the biodiversity increase. Then what happens? We dig a lot of pits. So when the water goes down into the pit, what happens to the water? A component goes to the groundwater. This per acre, we have computed that we send up to 4 million liters per acre per year as contribution to groundwater. A lot of percolation takes place under this system. Huge amount of percolation takes place. Okay. So this is in the groundwater. Then carbon sequestration. What have we done? I have told you that we use leaves, stem of 75% of the trees as nutrient source. So we put it into the soil. When you put biomass into the soil, it becomes soil carbon, isn't it? So this is a way of locking up carbon into the soil, and that is sequestration. The permanence, the lifespan of organic matter is between 200 to 2000 years. It will stay put, nothing is going to happen. So we are sequestering carbon by locking up carbon inside the soil. So this is also a great way to do carbon sequestration. This thing, most of the land in India and most of the people in India are not rich. I don't want to call them poor, but definitely they are not rich. So we are interested in that section. And these are people who have 1 acre, 2 acre, very small, very small. So we want, but they are a huge number. You have heard of this idea of bottom of the pyramid?
Yeah.
They are like that. They are the bottom of the pyramid. Now the question is, can we work with this bottom of the pyramid? Now, I made a rule for myself based on my experience. It is very easy to work with the bottom of the pyramid by using grants. There are enough NGOs, there are enough bleeding hearts to give money and work. Now, I said I want to do this with them without grants. Because the moment you give grant, that is the best way to kill the program. Because after the grant is over, they stop working. With a few exceptions. So, we are interested in working with this bottom of the pyramid but without grants. Not only that, to show that they are interested, they must also pay a cost to it. They cannot have it free. Okay, that's all. So this is what we have done. I'm trying to do this through a project from United Nations where it's kind of using ICT. So this is a part of the project. What we have done is, we have tried to, now how do you link with this large group of people? We cannot go to each one and start talking to them, right? So we have an NGO to facilitate, one NGO. But to each one, to communicate, we have now, through the mobile phone, we have created an interface, user interface, while I and them, we can talk to each other. So through mobile phone, we have done that. And now this mobile phone, we have done an interface, multimedia based interface, where we stay in touch with these farmers. And with them, we can implement. Right now, 25 farmers, small farm, marginal farmers, 2 acres land, they are doing this season. And we keep in touch using mobile phones. Okay, I don't go there, they don't come here, they don't need to see me. And this is a device by which there is an NGO to facilitate, to if there are difficulties, he will do with this. And this, I believe, is a scalable model. Is a scalable model. Okay? So based on that. And they have to do it because they believe that it is in their interest to do it. So there are no grants. It is their investment. They will have to do it. And this is the exercise that has begun.
And this is just to tell you that I have been involved in a project with EPF Lausanne in Switzerland and my own organization at IISc. We have been doing this project. So I have used project products. We use a lot of electronics to make our work. So this is a soil moisture measurement, and through Wi-Fi we gather a lot of data. So there is a lot of science and field data collection behind all this. So this is how we get data, and these are modeling soil moisture at different depths. So this is just to show you, and this is the interface. Now, why do I show you all this research? All this research is something which is at the back end. We have a lot of data that comes, measurements, soil moisture measurements, various parameters. We have simulation models running, but that is all in the back end. All of those data analytics and whatever we do is something which we utilize to do this. So on the cell phone, it is in my cell phone, you can see it. It is an app, it's an Android app. This is the app. It is first of all customized to this guy. Okay? It is customized to each plot. The first thing is customization. People need answers to which are specific to their plot, specific to that particular time. So it customizes to this plot. And then for any question he has, we get answers. We get customized answers. And for that, he will first tell about himself. He will tell us a lot of details. And this is through multimedia. So there is a voice activated. So on any icon, if he presses, there is a voiceover. Voiceover in local language. It is not in English, because in India, people speak different languages. In his local language, any icon he touches, there is a voiceover. So using that, we get all this. So, and for example, okay, there is something interesting. He gets, we always say people have questions, whether it is farming. Who has the answers? It is not that the scientists are the repository of all knowledge, right? So we gave answers in three different ways. One is, he gets three types of answers. One is the standard answer from the science and research. Second answer is from his peer group. So like Facebook, this particular thing tries to link him up with other farmers in the region. If he has a problem, 5,000 others in the region also have the same problem, right? At least 5 of them are smart. So we try to link up in real time. So this is the one I will show you this a little later. So in real time, they link up with their peer group. And now, in real time, they start asking, I have this pest, what do I do? So somebody else will say, okay, this is what I did and this is what happened. So there is a lot of peer group based answers. So we have got provisions for that. So they can, this is the screen that opens to that. And the third type of answer, these are examples. The third type of answer is simply based on experience, past experience. What do we do? You know, we are talking of uncertainty here. Remember, in uncertainty, what do? You look at trends, right? Stock market is uncertain. How do you play in stock market? By looking at trend, right? We do the same thing. You want to know what a crop does? How much yield you get? We look at past data. We have collected enough data. So we look at our past database, and he can even get answers from the actual data. So the three answers are from the science researchers, whatever they give you, or government department. Second, from the peer group. Third, simply based on experience from the past data. So we provide answers, and these are customized answers. And there is also a lot of data analytics that we do from measurements and all that. We also come in. So this is a mobile phone based device, which is in local language, which is interactive. This is used to keep in touch with a large number of farmers. This whole thing is automated. There is no human interference here. The whole thing sits on a server. So once it is automated, whether it is 10 or 10,000 is irrelevant, right? You just need to increase the capacity of the server. So this is what we believe. So there will be an NGO on ground. Then there is this kind of a setup we have made, NGO to facilitate. Using this, we try to work with small farmers, marginal farmers. Okay. And if there are any difficulties in communication, you need an NGO. So we directly work, customizing answers to them. And this, I believe, is a scalable model. So all our science, all our research is to give answers. Please remember, all your answers are useless unless you are able to communicate with them. One. Second, it is not a one-way communication. It is also a two-way communication. By communicating with them, we have learned a lot of new things. these people are incredibly smart. They have innovative ways of finding solutions which did not even occur to us. Okay, so in a way it becomes crowdsourcing for us. So a lot of solutions we have found, and we have actually put them in the database. We have put them in the database. So this has been a very interesting experience for us. So you skip all this, and so this is the way in which we would like to scale up. Whatever you see here, as of today, 25 small farmers have already taken it up. So you will not get 88, but you will get 70 cubic meters, right? So this is how you calculate runoff. So I had said this particular, as you are standing, right? So this has about 1 acre of runoff. So there is only about 44 cubic meters. So the average rainfall here is 66 centimeters. 66 centimeters into 44 cubic meters. That is the runoff that I get per year.
And what was the standard deviation you said?
For a minute we will take the average rainfall.
Average, okay.
So now, you stop me whenever something is not clear. So 66 centimeters into 44 cubic meters. That is what I should design for 1 acre to hold water. Ideal situation, yes. But no, because this 66 centimeters is distributed over time, no? It is distributed over from June to November. So all the 66 will not come. So you should look at spells of rainfall. You should look at rainfall spells. It is spread over time. So we said, look, the maximum it may come is 10 centimeters in 15 days. So what should be the capacity of my bucket which will store the water? You know, maximum is 10 into 44 cubic meters. That is what I should be looking at, 440 cubic meters maximum. Now, that is fine if I had unlimited money. Okay. So now we look at what is the chance of getting 10 centimeters in 15 days. Okay. Now, actually, since there is data, it is easy to work out. Then the value of 10 centimeters in 15 days was about, there is a small chance of about 20% of that coming. I don't want to play for the 20%. I'm not so rich. So then I look at what is the 75% chance. Most of the time what happens? Then the chance is, the maximum in 75% chance is about 4 centimeters in 15 days. 4 centimeters in 15 days, that is a 75% chance that I got. So I designed for 4 centimeters. 4 into 44. Okay. I look for about 200 cubic meters. I look for about 200 cubic meters design. Okay. Now 200 cubic meters design, now this is 1 acre. Now I know that it is possible to bring the water from somewhere else. I am not happy with this 1 acre. I think it is too less. I am greedy that now about 500 meters that side, where you will actually visit there, there is a stream going, which nobody wants. It is an unusual stream. I want to harvest that stream. So what I do is, I look at the contour roughly. Now I design bunds to bring all that water here. Now if you notice this bund here, can you notice this? You know what is a bund? Bund is an earthen embankment. Now this brings the water from 500 meters away. This carries the water. Now that 500 meters away, there the catchment area is about 25 acres. You see now, my planning is not for 200 cubic meters, but 25 into 200. You please get it? Because I am bringing the water from elsewhere. So this is where your catchment area, you understand something called a cascading flow? Okay, so you bring that water here. Now, so the 25 acres catchment area stream flow is actually coming through this and coming here. This is where it will end up. Now, when it comes, you can't get all of that. I will imagine, even if it is runoff, it will get distributed. It will get. So, we would say get only 50% of that. Here, I am planning for, you see, 200 into 12 acres. 200 into 12 is my number. Now, this is what I start with. This is my initial design.
Now I did this in 2009 I did that bund, the big one. You see, the big one. Can you see that big one there? This big one. See, then I measure. 2009 when there is rainfall, I measure runoff. Do I get that much? You know about measuring stream flow. We are able to, we kept a V notch, we measured stream flow. Then we decide whether am I actually getting that kind of runoff. We found that I was very conservative. I was getting more than what I had said. So then what I do, you can see the small bund there, small one. I add that in 2010. So you, the way to deal with this complex system is, though you do simulation modeling, you should not put all the bets on the simulation modeling run. You have to do measurements to substantiate your model. Your model is not true unless it is validated. There is something called validation. I make a model, but one season I validate my model. Are my flows correct? So that is measurement. There is no modeling involved. So I measured stream flow here. Once I found that we are getting more than what I had modeled, then I add one more. So this is how you do the design. Do a rough design, do measurements, and based on that measurement, you fine tune your design. So this is how I did. Okay. It should literally crawl. Okay. If you do straight down, it will run. So it should not run. So you make the water crawl and go like this. So it has been organized that way. So you increase the residence time. Once you increase the residence time, the percolation increases. So that is what we do.
Are you doing that with only the contours
and the bund. See, what we do is, if you see this bund, from here to there, you see it is maintained on a same level. So this is because you want to maintain the same contour. You don't allow the water to climb up and go down. The only outlet is there. So you maintain the same level on top of the bund. So the pits are dug to provide sufficient soil to maintain the same contour, isn't it? So that is the purpose of digging the pit. So it is always a pit and a bund. I will show you that there. But you realize the lot. If you say 14 lakhs, no farmer will do it. I have an estimate from a civil engineer on 14 lakhs. So at that 14 lakhs, no farmer will do it. At 70,000, 1 lakh or 100,000, somebody will do it. So it is also important to look at the economics of your solutions. You see? So that is, there is a reservoir which will store all the excess. Now we go to this water conservation structures. You see, this is how the water comes. Now, how do you store water? How do you make the water go down? You will see that. Now, this was a 2009 planting. 2009 planting has grown very well. Because 2009, we had about 60 centimeters of rainfall. There was good runoff. After 2009, the rainfall has never exceeded 40 centimeters. Our average is 60. Four consecutive years, we have less than 40 centimeters. Now, this appears to be a rare event. It has never occurred in 100 years. We checked. It has not only not occurred here, Raghu, we checked for entire South India. When I say we, JS checked for entire South India. Entire South India, minus one standard deviation, three consecutive years has never occurred.
I have to think about that because I have been working with Sudhimal. In North Karnataka, there is always a 3-4 year trend.
But minus one standard deviation continuously, yeah, consecutive 3 years.
Raghu, did you look at the Hurst phenomena here? How long the this things persist? How long these things persist?
Recharge, discharge. Yeah. 3-4 years.
But I will send you that. Please take a look. Please take a look at that map.
Send the data. There may be a persistence kind of phenomenon.
Yeah, yeah. Sure, I will send the data, but he knows JS. Yeah. So he will take it up.
JS will look at it.
JS look at it. I don't know that much of climate science to look at it. But I knew this demand, and JS did this analysis. I mean, I am not capable of doing that kind of an analysis. I mean, neither do I have the data. Grid data of South India.
This is the standard data, right, that we use?
Yeah.
What data do we use?
The
standard
grid data.
We use gauge data, but people also,
grid data also has. Grid data has this. So anyway, the point what we were discussing is,
This was an unusually low rainfall, 4 years consecutive. Okay. In spite of that, we have this growth. If it was a good rainfall, we would have had better growth. Now look at these trees. 2010 was a bad year. So all the trees planted in 2010, okay, are small. Planted 2009, they are good. One good year, if you are able to catch, your growth increases. See, there is an amplification of good events here. Because you are storing moisture and you are amplifying the effect of rainfall. Though it is 66 centimeters, by this runoff harvest, you are amplifying the rainfall and it becomes as if it is a 400 centimeter rainfall area. It becomes like Amazon forest. The growth rate can be as good as that because you are amplifying rainfall through these techniques. Okay? So, the good events, you get good things. And if there is a bad event, you see the difference. It hits you also badly. So, now coming back to what I wanted to show you, now you see there is good growth of some trees planted in 2009. Growth is a function of sunlight, water, and then what else? Nutrients. Soil means nutrients. See, if you give these three, it requires only these three, nutrients, soil, and water. You give these three, it must be able to grow. There should be almost an unlimited growth if you are able to give. Okay? Now, sunlight, as I said, tropics, no problem. In this shade also, it will have full photosynthesis in 50% shade. So, sunlight is not a problem. Our problem was water. We solved the problem of water by runoff harvest, I showed you. Then what is the next problem? Next problem is?
Nutrients,
right? Nutrients is the next constraint. Now, what do we do with nutrients? This is what we do with nutrients. In these pits, which is filled with water, we fill it up with biomass. Shankar, idi evaraina chupistava? Akkada chupistava? Okay, we have dug up some pits, we will show you. These pits get filled with biomass. What biomass? Anything, sticks, leaves, thorns, anything you put up. Now, if you put biomass, water and soil, what happens? Can you realize? What happens to the biomass? Sorry? It decomposes. So when it, how does it decompose? It decomposes by microbial decomposition. So decomposition is a two-way process. There is a macro fauna, you know, earthworms, lot of insects. First thing is done by earthworms, termites, lot of insects. So there is a lot of insect flora which comes and breaks it up. Earthworms are important. Lot of insect flora comes, they break it down, and then the microbes take over. Microbes take over and they take over in a huge number. As I said, microbes numbers is old. So this enriches, microbes enriches, then earthworms come. Do you know what an earthworm does? It bores holes. Earthworms eat the soil and bores holes. So if you have earthworms here, I will show you photos. If you lift your hand, it will be full of earthworms. So those earthworms actually burrow into the soil. Now this is 1 meter pit. The earthworms go up to 2 meters. They burrow into the soil. Thousands of earthworms, tens of thousands will burrow. Once they burrow holes into the soil, what happens to the percolation? Percolation increases, right? That is one part. So there is decomposition, there is earthworm activity, then the percolation increases. Then, if you notice the trees here, see, this is what I was talking of, 75% to 25%. These are 75% of the trees, which are cut to provide nutrients to the 25%. See, these are the timber trees. These are trees which are fodder trees. They are meant for manure. They are meant to provide nutrients. These belong to family leguminosae. They fix nitrogen. You heard of nitrogen fixation? So all of them are legumes. So these fix nitrogen. Not only that, we cut them and put them here so that you get the nutrients for big growth of this. So this is how you are able to generate nutrients in situ. When you generate nutrients in situ, please remember, the earthworms come, that is one part, so they burrow into the soil. Second part is, when you do this, so much of trees, I will again, we have dug up a pit and shown you, this will be full of roots. See, there will be no place to keep your hand, this is full of roots, okay? Inside if you open, we have opened up a few pits for you. It will be so full of roots. When so much of roots come in, what happens to the pit?
the pits get filled up by the root and the roots go down, right? Root go down in search of water. Now the roots actually penetrate and loosen your soil. Earthworms are loosening the soil. We will show you how the roots actually, the roots are so powerful. Have you seen rocks being split by roots? You have seen that? If the roots can split rocks, this soil is nothing for them. The deep soil again gets split by roots. That is why we need to have a lot of trees. Why do you need to have so much of trees? Not only for nutrients, but also for deepening the pit, breaking the soil. They break the soil and go inside. Okay? Now this becomes a virtuous cycle. Once the soil is broken, water enters, earthworms enter. Once the water enters, root further enters, right? Roots are looking for water. So now this becomes a virtuous cycle. So now we will dig pits and show you. When I dug 2009, I'll come to you. It was 1 meter. Now it is more than 2 meters. The depth increases. You see, we have not dug the next 1 meter. The next 1 meter is dug by roots and earthworms. Now we started with 1 meter. Now all I will show you some pits there. They are all now 2 meters, 3 meters deep pits. When the depth of the pit increases, the volume of water storage, what happens? Increases, right? Isn't it? So now this is what I call as self-perpetuating processes, life, you know. So we will see this. So that was the purpose. Now, due to decomposition, the nutrients get released. These nutrients are nutrients which are not from this biomass. You must know that 99.8% of the nutrients are locked in the soil. You see, soil is extremely rich in nutrients, but they are not in available form. Phosphorus gets locked as aluminium phosphate and ferrous phosphate. If you are able to release it, okay, then you don't need to apply phosphorus. Phosphorus is the costliest fertilizer. Do you know that? You know, at least in India, for a kg of phosphorus, we spend about 60 rupees, 70 rupees. Whereas a huge amount of phosphorus is sitting in the soil as ferrous and aluminium phosphate. They are locked. Okay? So, you need to release it. Now, microbes, when they are acting, when the roots are exuding, there are special kinds of microbes which solubilize phosphorus. They are called phosphate solubilizing group. There are fungi and bacteria which specialize in solubilizing phosphorus. Now, they come into action and they solubilize phosphorus, and the phosphorus does not come from even this. Most of the phosphorus comes from release of the nutrients from the soil by microbial action and root action. Roots release a lot of acids like oxalic acid, gibberellic acid. There are a whole lot of acids, muric acid, a whole lot of acids get released by the roots. Due to action of the acids, the phosphates get released. As I said, in that nutrient balance I have shown you, we have measured how much phosphates get released from the roots, from the soil. So lot of nutrients come, okay? And now that is how we take care of the nutrient constraint. So we have taken care of the water. Sunlight we don't need to do, we have taken care of the water. The nutrients come through this process of decomposition, not from the biomass. The biomass you put is a starter material to increase the microbial population. The microbes actually release the nutrient from the soil. So please don't think this biomass gives you nutrient. This is a starter dose. It starts a virtuous cycle of increasing the microbial population and the earthworm population and the other macrofauna. The actual release comes from soil fixed nutrients.
So once you have started this process, where are the interventions needed?
There is no intervention needed. This is, you can keep quiet. That is why the company is so happy. This is where we can keep quiet. You can see, as I said, all the hard work is in the beginning. Your design has to be good. Your design has to be good. Then you don't need to do much. See, things like you should cut them and put them here. Things like that. You don't need to do much. You should cut them, put them here. There are interventions like you should make the timber tree straight. You see, it should be like this. It should be like an electric pole. Now that is a bad one. We have not done it well. You see this? That is a bad one. You see, this is good. You can see this thing is more of maintenance. You don't need to do anything because for any timber, it has to be straight. If it is not straight, you don't get the money. Okay? So there are things like this. And
So the one issue I see though is somehow you're not yet, maybe, that resilient to persistence of rocks. And maybe it's impossible to be that.
It is not impossible. Yeah, you are very right. It is impossible to be completely resilient. But if there is an event which has not occurred in 100 years, you know, in a conventional system where you don't do all this, trees will die.
I'll question that 100-year business, but we can leave
that for another business. You keep it for that. Yeah. But as I said, I am only quoting what somebody else told me because I am not even expert on this.
Sure.
I mean, I just asked a question and they were kind enough to answer that. And see, this is where the nutrients come. Now, I believe I have addressed how we take care of the three constraints. Two constraints. Sunlight is not a constraint in tropics. Water, I have said. Nutrients, I have said. And now, if these two basic things are there, you should have a huge amount of growth. Now, how do you organize this growth? How do you organize this growth? How do you take care of this growth? There are a few more things to do to ensure this growth. We will walk along and then we talk. Right now, you had something to ask me, no? Water on the flow is one part. But you see, what controls this factor? Why do you need to make things far off? Why do you make things close by? Huh? That is also one part, but the real reason is a little different.
Part. Lunch will be half an hour.
Lunch will be...
Are they on the same height level?
No. Here, you see, what should be the, if you bring it close by, you have more number of picks per unit area, right? If you make it far off, you have less number of picks per unit area. Am I correct? Isn't it? So, you have less number of picks here, you have more number of picks here. Why do you need to have more number of picks? Because there the supply of water is high. You need to have less number of picks if the supply of water is low. So remember, every time, how many picks you put, you should always keep in mind the runoff. Here there is a high runoff, here there is a low runoff, so I decrease the number of picks. Okay? So it is not that you go to a land, start digging pits, no. How much pits you put has to be tailored to the amount of runoff that you get. So that is the designing part. Okay? So it is not that you go on digging pits. It has to be according to a design, and that is what happens. There is a high runoff, here there is a low runoff, and that is how we increase the width. We increase the width. Okay? And now, if you increase the width, not only the number of pits reduce, the number of trees also reduce. No? If the supply is less, you should reduce your demand, isn't it? See, this is an exercise of matching supply and demand. It is a dynamic matching of supply and demand of soil water. This whole thing can be thought of as a dynamic exercise of matching of supply and demand in time, isn't it? So if the supply is less, you should decrease the demand. How do you decrease the demand? Have less number of pits and have less number of trees. Okay? One tree takes 40 liters per day. Okay? So, 60 days as rainfall days, let us take 300 days. So, 300 into 40. One tree of this size requires 1,200 liters of water. Not 12,000 liters of water. Okay. 40 into 300 is 12,000 liters. So, 12,000 liters. One cubic meter is 1,000 liters of water. So, if I have 100 trees, it will not grow well unless I have 100 into 12,000 liters of water. Can you make this large? So you need to have these numbers in mind before you plant trees. If you don't do this matching, then your growth will come down. You see? So there is a lot of design, there is a lot of calculation like this. So now, before planting 100 trees, you must make sure, does it receive 12,000 into 100 liters of water? Okay? If yes, you can populate, otherwise you cannot. So there are these elements of design, and many of you asked, why is it that you cannot upscale it? Why can't you put it to farms? Why can't you do it in 1,000 acres? The difficulty is this whole model will fail if it is not well designed. You see, I hope you are able to appreciate the amount of design that is involved. You do a bad design, you don't get the growth. You don't get the growth.
We have some good.